everybody, and welcome to The Common Good. I'm Patricia Duff, and tonight we have a really important discussion with author Kati Marton on the life and legacy of German Chancellor Angela Merkel. We'll hear about her rise and reign and how Merkel's departure from the European scene may affect Europe today, especially with Russia threatening Europe's eastern flank and Ukraine. But before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge a few VIPs and a few honorables in the audience. Welcome to our honorable advisory board members, Jane Harman, the congresswoman who is also an expert in her own right on international affairs, Kay Koplowitz, former New York First Lady, Silda Wall Spitzer, Byron Wien, and Anita. We have Ambassador Donald and Vera Blinken with us tonight, Ambassador Joe Paolino, the Honorable Gillian Sorensen, Bente Strong, Sally Menard, Ernie Pomerantz, Ken Miller, Hope Winthrop, and of course, many other truly engaged notables who help make our country better are in the audience today. So thanks for joining us. We also have members of the press, and we always welcome them because they're so important to our democracy, current or lapsed. So we're pleased to welcome Gillian Tett of the FT, Yuradi Kazikas, Nancy Collins, Aaron Moriarty, and Ann Cunningham. Thank you. You know, at The Common Good, we work to share sharp and informative discussions on today's critical issues. And that does include the leadership and legacy of some of the world's most powerful leaders. So we know that open dialogue and informed understanding of recent events and the past is critically important for learning how to protect and improve our democracy going forward. And Kati's going to have something to say about that, even with respect to Hungary. That's really important today. But these conversations would not be possible without your participation and your support. So thank you all for joining us here today. It wouldn't be the same without you. So let me introduce our incredible guest, starting with Kati Marton. Anyone who knows Kati knows she is a force. She's a woman with brilliant and wide-ranging interests and accomplishments with a life and background that could be cut out of a novel, starting with her her childhood in Hungary to journalist parents who suffered through the Soviet occupation there, including imprisonment, and whose experiences help inform Kati's approach, I'm sure, to Angela Merkel. Kati is an award-winning former NPR and ABC news correspondent. She's done significant work as an activist and advocate for human rights and freedom of the press, and she is a prolific author. She's written 10 books, four of which have been bestsellers, including this biography, The Chancellor, The Remarkable Odyssey of Angela Merkel, and she has gotten unbelievable reviews. The New York Times called it a masterpiece of discernment and insight. You got to read it. Unfortunately, it's been sold out right now, so you may have to wait for your copy, but please, I recommend you read it. It's a deeply researched and reported biography of Merkel, who until quite recently has been one of the most important leaders in Europe and the world. And Kati, you're amazing. Welcome. We're so honored to have you.
Thank you so much. I love that introduction. I just wish it wouldn't be so short. Could you just expound a little bit more?
There's a lot more to say, but we're also honored to have a very dear friend of too many years to mention, John Emerson, who will be our moderator tonight. And he has a lot in common with our guest. A keen knowledge of Germany and Europe. Kati was married to Richard Holbrooke, who was ambassador to Germany, and John served as US ambassador to Germany stationed in Munich during the Obama years. And I was thrilled to visit John and his wonderful wife, Kimberly, there while he was stationed there. John has returned to the financial advisory firm he left to serve in Germany as vice chairman of Capital International. But as ambassador, he interacted at the highest levels of the US and German governments, as well as with the EU and NATO leaderships. John, thank you so much for being with us. And I will now pass the conversation over to you.
Well, thank you, Patricia. And you know, you're such a dear friend. I have to say, I'm so proud and impressed by what you have done with the Common Good.
You're here.
And just listening to all those folks who are here, so many from dear friends of mine from, you know, Ambassadors Blinken and Paolino. And by the way, another great book to read is Vera and the Ambassador, which the Blinkens wrote after serving there. And we are also so proud of your son, Tony, who's doing such an extraordinary job as our Secretary of State. and Yurate. It's great to reconnect with you. And of course, my former law partner and dear friend, Jane Harmon, who I've known probably about as long as I've known you, Patricia, maybe even a little bit longer. Okay. So it's great, kind of an old home week, and it's just great to be with all of you here from sunny Southern California. And Kati, the brilliant, incisive, prolific Kati Marton, we had so many times together in Berlin when we were there. It was just wonderful. The guidance that you gave to Kimberly and me as having been there before, and just the friendship that we developed over the years, and the opportunity we had to talk and continue and build on that friendship afterwards. So it's wonderful to have the chance to do this with you. So let's get to it.
Yes, I'd love to just say, can I just break in for 1 second and tell you and Patricia both how this is the conversation I was really looking forward to. Patricia is a dear friend of mine as well, and everything she said about me, back at you, girlfriend. And John, you did. I had high standards for the role of ambassador to Germany from Richard. And boy, oh boy, you and Kimberly really surpassed everything. Oh, so thank you for that. And we need you back doing many, many more things on behalf of the nation at this really critical time. But now let's go back to this lady, and because there's so much that you and I can chew over, and you were so helpful in this process of trying to decode this most private public person on the planet.
Well, that's actually a great way to start. I mean, what struck me about the book was your ability to sort of go back into her past, her upbringing, and sort of draw some of the lines and the connections between how she was raised, the experience in the former East, the struggle with being a woman. A woman from the East in terms of working her way up through what I can tell you, and I'm sure you'll agree, is very, very much of a boys network in Germany. Honestly, it still is in many respects. And why don't we start with what are the personal characteristics of Angela Merkel that you would really look to attribute to her success?
Great, great starting point, John. Because as I say in my preface to the book, this is not essentially a political book. It's a character study. It's the human Merkel, because that was what drew me to the subject. Frankly, the machinations of the Bundestag, I don't find as sexy a subject as the character study of this incredibly complicated and brilliant and interesting woman, who, by the way, is not who we think she is. She's vastly more interesting, but she did not want this or any other book that really penetrated her steely facade written about her. But that's what I set out to do, precisely to answer those questions that you raise: how this triple outsider from the East, a woman and a scientist. She was a physicist until at age 35, the wall fell in 1989. And at that point, she took off her lab coat and went looking for a political party. So in fact, she had chosen science as a safe place to park that remarkable brain of hers, that sheltered from the Stasi, sheltered from the police state, because it's harder to manipulate science than any other field. But her meteoric rise was astonishing. And to answer your question in this long-winded way, I think the qualities that she brought to this profession were, okay, let's start with the obvious fact that she is brilliant. She has a photographic memory. She could have chosen any field. And she has amazing composure and self-control. And as a result, she was constantly, every step of the way, underestimated. And as a result, the graveyard behind the Bundestag is full of the bodies of those who underestimated her, whom she eventually decapitated, not literally, but
or, you know, or kneecapped might be another way to put it.
Okay, better than yeah, kneecapped, because they didn't see it coming. So I must say we can all learn from her. Anybody interested in power, how to get it and how to keep it. She was, okay, elected once, that happens. Four times, so 16 years as the most powerful leader in Europe. And not to jump too far ahead, but boy, do we miss her now with Ukraine. Anyway,
well, we'll get to that. We'll get to that. I think that'll be a very, interesting conversation, and you know, particularly her relationship with Vladimir Putin. But you know, one of the things you mentioned was her self-control. Why don't you tell a little bit of that story with one of her earlier meetings with Putin?
Yeah. So Putin, like Trump, somewhat later, but Putin is her longest running dysfunctional marriage. I mean, 3 decades of ceaseless interaction, and they have, they're like two battle-tested warriors. They have a very clear understanding of each other. They speak each other's language, is because she had to learn Russian as a under Soviet occupation, and he learned German as the KGB agent in Dresden. So they start with that. Plus she's a great admirer of Russian culture, which has also helped their relationship. You know, all the Russian classics she read as a young person living in an isolated village in the east in Brandenburg, which is where a lot of her self-possession comes from, because she really had to rely on herself, because she was the daughter of a Lutheran pastor, very a hard man with incredibly unmeetable standards, which she never felt that she gained his approval, but the father taught her critical thinking and also the deep faith, which of course is a significant part of who she is and how she has governed. She considers faith, by the way, to be a private matter, but she is a Lutheran. She's not a church-going Lutheran, but the faith that she imbibed as the pastor's daughter of responsibility toward others and the daily work of salvation, these of course came to the world's attention in 2015 when she allowed 1 million Middle Eastern refugees to enter Germany. And for many people, that was a shock, because it was so out of keeping with her normally super cautious style, but not a shock to those who really knew her. They considered this her Martin Luther moment. You remember Luther, who said, "Here I stand, I can do no other." That was her moment. But again, I've flashed forward to the piece of her legacy that I consider most extraordinary. There's a long list of things that in the way that she transformed Germany without Germans really being aware that they were being transformed, because this is part of her key, is she works sideways, not frontally. So she gets things done very quietly, and it's remarkable how much you can get done if you don't take credit for it. So her politics is an ego-free politics from which we can all learn.
Well, you know, she was often accused of, quote, leading from behind, you know, and that was part of that brilliance, right? You know, let others get out there and they say, well, you know, it was interesting reading all the reviews of Angela Merkel, you know, I suppose you could call them obituaries, living of her time in office. One of the criticisms was, well, you know, she always seemed to be a little bit behind where the public was and waited for them. And then she'd go out on front. You know, yeah, she managed crises well, but you know, she didn't really prepare for the future. Excuse me? I mean, you want to talk about the definition of a leader? How about managing crises? How about, you know, helping us, you know, solidify the reunification of Germany? How about dealing with the global financial crisis? How about dealing with the first war in, which is ongoing, as we know, in Ukraine? How about dealing with the refugee crisis? How about dealing with Donald Trump? I mean, there are all sorts of examples of how she just did an extraordinary job of that. And this idea of leading from behind, I love your observation about not caring about who gets the credit. The fact is, she got so much done.
Yes, yes, that's it. And sorry, John, I don't think I answered your question about the first meeting with Putin. So Putin, KGB trained, obviously, was determined to shake her composure. And he did this. He did his homework, knew that she was afraid of dogs, having twice been bitten. So he unleashed his big black lab, Coney, who went right for her, to the horror of her staff standing there going, oh my God. She just turned into a block of ice, as if she didn't even notice that this big black beast was sniffing all around her. So, but Putin never stopped trying to rattle her, nor did he ever succeed. By the way, same can be said for Trump, who she also drove Trump a little bit crazy, because she just doesn't take the bait. I mean, another lesson, you know, sometimes I felt like I was writing volume 2 of Machiavelli's The Prince, only it would be The Princess, because there are so many lessons in how to outsmart your enemies with such a subtle stiletto. And here's another thing that she transformed in Germany. You mentioned early, John, that it's a male political culture. Well, it was. It is no more. It is her. She surrounded herself with powerful women. And so, unlike Margaret Thatcher, who wouldn't be caught dead in the same room with another woman, she liked being the only man in the room. Merkel, and I observed this in my encounters with her, she really likes women and really likes strong women. And as a result, you know, her protege, Ursula von der Leyen, is now the head of the European Commission. And you look at the Bundestag today, and it's full of would-be Merkel. So she opened up that space. Women in Germany tend to say, oh, but she never gave a speech about how women need support. Well, that isn't her way. First of all, she's a very poor speaker. Let me just hasten to add that this is not a hagiography. I see her blind spots, and she never did master the performative aspect of her role, but that worked fine in Germany, where people have memories of where charismatic leaders can lead. So she benefited from that.
I think that's absolutely right. I mean, just two observations on that. First of all, as a dog guy, when I heard years ago that it was a Labrador retriever, I thought it was going to lick her to death. But I get that she'd been bitten by dogs and was concerned about that. Yeah. But and then the second thing on the speech is, you're absolutely right. And there was sort of almost a dispassionate, you know, very pragmatic, very science-like approach to her speaking style. But as I know we're going to get to Q&A in a minute, I see my pal Jane Harmon has her hand up. But as Jane will recall, about 3 years ago at the Munich Security Conference, right when there was this battle between Trump and Merkel, she came in, did not mention his name once. She followed Pence. Pence gave a speech, and then Merkel came in and just sort of ticked off what it means to be a leading democratic nation in today's world. I mean, that would be the subtext. Yeah. And she got a standing ovation. I've been going to these things since 2014. I know you've been to a bunch of them. I don't think I've ever seen any leader get a standing ovation from that. So when the need was there, she could definitely periodically pull it out. But you're right about the whole idea of Germans being a little, and Olaf Scholz isn't exactly a barn burner either.
No, but what Olaf Scholz, and he's very new on the job, but you know, he's plunged right into his first crisis. And what I noticed in comparing how she approached the first Russian invasion in 24 of Ukraine, she never she led Europe in that, because Obama said to her, "This man Putin just lies to me all the time. I can't deal with this man." Well, Merkel said, well, he lies to me too, but she did not have the luxury of that choice. So at that point, Obama handed off the leadership of the West to Merkel, and she never went into those hours and hours of talks with Putin without taking other European leaders with her. But at the same time, because the last thing she wants is for Germany to be perceived as the leader of Europe. She's so hyper aware of German history, not only toward Russia, which is a factor in today's unfolding crisis, because Germans, of course, feel a certain responsibility for the wide scale deaths incurred by World War II, which they started as they started World War I, and of course the Holocaust. But she, more than any prior chancellor, German history has played a role in how she, the subtle way in which she approached being the chancellor of Europe, which she's well aware that she was. I mean, next to Hollande, no contest.
Yeah, well, I was actually in the room for all of those discussions with Obama and Merkel, because that, of course, happened on my watch. And I would say it was a little less than a handoff and more of a partnership. Maybe Obama was leading from behind with Merkel, but for sure she took the leadership with the Normandy process with Hollande, Poroshenko, and Putin, and trying to develop the Minsk Accords and all that. But you're absolutely right. And this was sort of an eye opener to me too, is watching her get on the plane and go to Tallinn, Estonia, and go to Latvia, and sit down. And she was so, this was about pulling the EU together so that their sanctions against Russia were quite close to ours, because what Obama didn't want and we didn't want was for it to appear, Putin loves nothing more than to drive a wedge between Europe and the United States, right? That there was that, oh, this is just an anti, an American anti-Russia thing going on. And that took a lot of work, because there are a number of countries in the EU, member states in the EU, who are dependent, more dependent for sure on Russia than Germany certainly is. And she worked it and worked it and worked it. She'd had some help. The shooting down of MH17, that tragedy over Ukraine, clearly helped to solidify the member states of the European Union. But on another point, talking about today and this whole issue of Germany providing helmets but not providing arms, she was adamant that because, to your point about understanding history, looking at history, looking at the European history in particular, and knowing Vladimir Putin, she said, if we arm the Ukrainians with lethal offensive aid, that's like in a poker game where you say, oh, I'm going to raise you. Putin will say, I'll see you and I'll raise you, and you're never going to win that game. Yeah. And the idea of patience was something that she saw as ultimately an important quality for winning the Cold War, if you will, just to your point.
Yeah, no, the stamina that she has in negotiations. I mean, she was always the last to leave the table. Others were dropping off already. But as long as there was an inch of ground to be gained, she said of those talks during the Minsk talks that the only way she knew the time of day was whether they were serving bread and jam or a roast. So that level of focus, and which you can trace back to her training as a scientist, that she just has the ability to block out everything when she is that focused, and her mastery of detail. I observed my Richard negotiating with the Balkan warlords, and so I have a high standard for negotiation. But what she and Richard, of course, famously used a great deal of threats and charm, and ultimately locking the door and throwing away the key until they signed. There was more to it than that, but with Merkel, it's something different. She has a mastery of the minutia. She says she knows every tree in the Donbass, for example.
Wow.
As a result, Putin just couldn't blow smoke at her.
Right.
Because she knew precisely how far his little green men, as they were called, his militia that he denied were his militia, precisely what they had done the night before. So again, a lesson for future negotiators, diplomats, that you know, mastery of detail, and the other thing is that because she has observed macho men her entire life as the only woman in the room for much of her career, she knows how to, she lets them bluster on and until they kind of self-immolate as Gerhard, and she doesn't run for the hose. She lets them burn. I mean, she doesn't start the fire, but nor does she run for the garden hose. And that's what, of course, happened with her first great mentor, Helmut Kohl, who she was the only one in the CDU who had the courage. She, his protege, who had the courage to say, Helmut, you're doing more harm than good to the CDU. It's time to go. And that, yeah. She wrote that famous op-ed, front page, Frankfurter Allgemeine. And that was the end of Kohl. He never forgave her. But same with Gerhard Schroeder, who also, she just let him bluster on election night. They were too close to call. And he just couldn't believe that this plain woman would have defeated him, Gerhard Schroeder. And so she just let him go on and on and on. And I've watched this tape a million times. And at one point she realizes that he's done it. He's done himself in. And she leans into the mic and says, Gerhard, the fact is you didn't win. I mean, in that dead calm voice of hers, which drove autocrats bananas, you know, from Erdogan to Orban to Trump, you know, that the fact that she never raises her voice, she doesn't, it's as if, and she has an ability, Ambassador Haber, her ambassador in Washington, told me that one of her techniques when she is across the table from one of these blustering macho guys is to repeat what they just said, only in this sort of childlike language. So, you know, she reduces Trump or Putin's grandiosity into, so how much of the world do you think you need to conquer to be, you know, I mean, I'm making that up, but you know, she makes them look ridiculous. And because she has the moral authority, she can get away with it. I mean, so many lessons for our politicians. And one other thing, John, 16 years without a breath
stunning
of scandal.
Stunning. I mean,
not a single tell-all book has come out of the chancellery. I mean, you know, for us Americans who you know, people start writing their tell-all books as they're packing their White House kit. Remarkable. I do not think she will write her own book, however.
Yeah, I let me tell you, I've had several book agents approach me about getting through. Absolutely no interest in doing that. I mean, that's an interesting thing. What do you think she will do? What is the, after she takes her 6 months and sort of catches her breath, what do you see her teaching? What role do you think she'll play?
Well,
besides going to a lot of operas.
Yeah, for sure. With the Phantom of the Opera, as her husband is known, Herr Dr. Sauer. The fact is that there's no job in the world that would tempt her. And she was offered a big job by the Secretary General of the UN 2 weeks ago. And I wasn't at all surprised when she turned that down after being Chancellor of Germany. What job is there? But I think that after a well-deserved rest, because when you think about it, she's free for the first time in her life. I mean, you think about 35 years under the Stasi and then 16 years as chancellor. She's never been free. I think she will savor her freedom, her newfound freedom, and with her scientist's eyes, observe her own reaction to how she deals with that. And if she discovers that she misses being at the table with the powerful, she will have ample ways to weigh in. And I think in two areas, she will weigh in. And one is her unfinished business of climate, which she really was she announced in her, she gives one address to the nation New Year's Eve, and she announced in January of 2020 that's what she would do for the remainder of her term, climate. And then of course, 6 weeks later,
COVID.
Came COVID, and she became again crisis manager. So I think climate. And the other thing is, I think she will be engaged with women, in particularly in Africa, women who are not doing as well as we many of us in the West are. So I think those are two things that are close to her heart. And I, you know, she really needs, we need her. We need that presence, and we need that moderate tone, and that calm, that surreal calm, which you experienced, I experienced, and the wit. I mean,
yeah, she's got a great sense of humor. Oh, most people don't know that.
Yeah, she when she was
kind of impish, actually.
When she was asked, "What is it about your homeland that you love?" You know, expecting some big blustery answer, she said, "We have very nice draft-proof windows." I mean, how's that to be the anti?
They actually do.
I know they do, but I mean.
No, that's funny. Well, the story I always tell is one of the first times I spent time with her. Is it Kimberly and I and she and Dr. Sauer sat together at the 50th anniversary of the Berlin Philharmonie, and there was just like, you know, speech after speech after speech about what happened 50 years ago and how the world changed and so on and so forth. And at one point, during a moment of quiet, somebody's cell phone rang, and she nudged me and she goes, "But that didn't happen 50 years ago."
Yeah.
And and the other thing I'll remember from that is they actually showed footage of after the days after the, you know, the Mauer fall, the fall of the wall, there was a concert, and Barenboim conducted the Berlin Philharmonic in Ode to Joy, right?
Yes.
And they played a portion of that, you know, on film. And I said to her, I said, "Were you there?" And she goes, "No, I wasn't there, but I listened on the radio and I knew I could have been there." And that was what was so significant. So, so I thought that was kind of interesting. Yeah. Hey, let's talk about, you've mentioned a couple of times her moral authority and, you know, obviously going back, I would assume, to, you know, growing up as a pastor's daughter and what she learned there and all that. And, you know, today we, you know, President Biden always talks about we're in a battle between authoritarianism and democracy or what have you. And, you know, there are even some folks with authoritarian bent in countries, you know, quite well. And just what lessons can we learn from Angela Merkel in terms of dealing with this whole tension or this dynamic of authoritarianism versus democracy, and you know, in particular, you might want to share some of your thoughts about Hungary in that regard.
Yes, well, as you know, I grew up in a similar totalitarian state as a child of political prisoners, and by the way, I think that gave me a tiny edge with her because she had read my memoir, Enemies of the People.
A great memoir, by the way.
Thank you.
Is that one out? It's still, we can buy that one still?
Absolutely. Yes.
Yeah, that's a fantastic book.
Fabulous. Oh, thanks, Patricia. Yeah. Well, anyway, it's, I think that helped me A, to win her trust, and B, to understand her, because to understand her need for control and her need and her suspicious nature, because her lab partner turned out to be informing on her, and that was just pretty much routine. And so she has reason not to be particularly trusting. It was devastating for her. She admires our country perhaps more than any prior chancellor. She had a picture of the elder Bush and Ronald Reagan in her office, because she considered, you know, them the giants of the Cold War, and in a personal way, they gave her her second chance by ending the Soviet occupation. So I think it was devastating for her when Obama called her and to tell her that Trump had won the election, but her many Republican friends and advisors, Henry Kissinger among them, told her to practice strategic patience, and well, that didn't work out too well. But sadly, those were sort of wasted years in the transatlantic relationship, which, by the way, for her is the key to Germany's well-being, NATO and the transatlantic relationship. Those are fundamental for her, which is why just to insert a line about her role during the financial crisis, which I criticize her for, because she was so single-minded about imposing austerity, particularly on Greece. But the reason that she was so almost pious in insisting on Greek austerity was because she wanted to keep Greece in the EU. Schäuble, her finance minister, did not let them go.
He floated that, yeah, step out for a couple of, not just in the EU, in the Eurozone.
Right.
I mean,
and she was just determined to keep the EU solidly united. And you can only imagine, you don't have to imagine that Brexit was a huge blow for her, but she wasn't gonna let anybody else leave the EU, not on her watch. And this brings me to Hungary, my former homeland, which now is heading in exactly the wrong direction. And I my first real political activism, which at my stage, I've just begun to try to rally the Hungarian diaspora, which is quite large, to vote if they can in the upcoming elections in April, because for the first time Orban is in jeopardy. There's a very good man behind whom the opposition has united, a moderate conservative, but she felt that dealing with Orban was deeply frustrating, because he defies all the EU values, and really is much closer to Putin than he is to Berlin to and Brussels, ideologically. But she didn't want to lose she didn't want to lose Hungary as an EU member. So for her, after NATO and the Transatlantic Union, the united EU were fundamental, because the last thing she wants is for Germany to be alone again, or Germany to be first again. And these were, I mean, it was quite a needle to thread, as it was for her to thread the Xi Jinping's increasingly autocratic turn. But she made more trips to Beijing than any other head of state.
Well, she made more. I always used to respond when people would get upset about pivot to Asia. Well, yes. You know, Angela Merkel's been to Beijing a lot more than she's been to Washington, D.C. In her time. But anyway, yes. Hey, we've got a lot of questions that are pending. And I first want to go to Jane Harman, who patiently has been waiting. And then next we're going to go to Eleanor Clift, who I think we all know and read. But Jane, the floor is yours.
Well, Kati, congratulations on yet another great book.
Oh, thank you so much, Jane. It's so nice to see you.
Nice to see you too. And John, serve a shout out as a fabulous U.S. ambassador to Germany.
Yes, he sure was.
So country, and is still teaching us all about Germany, and your enthusiasm for the country is just, it's wonderful. Anyway, and I'll see you at the Munich Security Conference, I assume.
Yep, okay. Couple of weeks.
So I have a two-part question. I was on the floor of Congress when Merkel spoke, gave the address.
Oh, yes.
She spent the first part of that address, I'll never forget it, talking about growing up in Eastern Europe and dreaming about buying a pair of blue jeans.
Right.
The center of her universe was to own a pair of blue jeans or somehow to smuggle them in from the West. And then she finally got the blue jeans. I mean, this is all in this talk. And then she talked about it and she got a lot more. I mean, she got, you know, Germany ultimately was unified, and then she ended up where she is and so on and so on. But my question is, beyond the slightly overbearing father that she had, and the access to a good education, what was the impact on her and her personality and her leadership of growing up behind the Iron Curtain? That's part one. And the second part, which is not identical, is I'm just struck by the picture on your book of her, which is beautiful. And I think most of us remember, with all affection, a slightly frumpy woman with no jewelry, hair, you know, indifferent, a bright colored jacket, but the same black attire all the time. And no attention paid to her appearance. Most women politicians are told you have to, you know, get your hair done and wear makeup and all the rest. She never did that, in contrast almost everybody else. And I wonder if that actually helped her effectiveness, because she wasn't threatening in a certain way.
Right. She was very womanly. I hope you'll read my book, because I deal with both those questions at great length, both with the question of the blue jeans, which, by the way, she was among the first in East Germany to get a pair of blue jeans. And she was called to the principal's office for so doing, because that was non-proletarian garb. So, you know, you ask how that upbringing impacted on her. Well, she is, for Angela Merkel, the word freedom is not an abstract term. It's very real. And one of her foundational policies is she hates leaders who imprison their populations, as she was imprisoned for 35 years. I mean, the first time she was in West Berlin was the night the wall fell. So she is in Merkel, the Germans had someone who had a lived experience of the absence of freedom. And that I think was also a huge part of who she was. On her appearance, Jane, you might be surprised to know, I interviewed her hairdresser. That's the kind of researcher I am. The first time she went to get highlights was in preparation for meeting George W. Bush. And she liked the highlights so much, she came back every 6 months for more highlights. And she had a makeup artist waiting for her every morning in her office as her national security advisor, who was one of my best sources, Christoph Heusgen, told me. She arrived to the chancellery, quote, as God made her. And then as she read her tablet to catch up on the world news, was transformed into that. She made a non-story of her. She was shocked that so much attention was paid to what she wore and her shoes and everything. So she made that a non-story by getting a closet full of identical jewel-toned jackets and black pants and black flats. I once saw her, Jane, shopping for shoes at the Galerie Lafayette in Berlin, and while her security guys, you know, pretended to disappear, she bought six pairs, I kid you not, of identical black flats, and that was it for the year. So, but she made it a non-story because she always looked good in the jewel-toned jackets and the black pants. It was sort of a woman's equivalent of a pinstripe suit. And after that, the only time anybody ever wrote about her appearance was when she shocked the world, when she showed up, John, maybe you were there. She showed up, I believe, to the Oslo Opera in an extremely plunging neckline.
Yeah.
And everybody went bananas. And by the way, she looked great. Um, but, um, but, but she didn't, you know, she didn't want that to be the story. So she never wore that dress again, sadly. She's not a woman. I interviewed Kevin Rudd, the former Prime Minister of Australia, who spent quite a bit of time with her. And he said, you know, she wasn't like Golda Meir, you know, trying to be the cozy granny making me tea. Dealing with her was dealing with a non-gendered great leader. You kind of forgot her, which is the point, isn't it? We want to be taken for more than, you know, the cut of our.
Yeah, no question about that. I also remember from being at some black tie events with her, like the Bayreuth opera, Benta Strong, you'll appreciate that.
Yes.
She had different long gowns, but they were exactly the same, you know, yeah. The same gown. We have a few more questions. So Eleanor Clift, and then after Eleanor, we're gonna go to Hope Winthrop and then Steve Cohen. So Eleanor, floor is yours. Unmute yourself, please.
Those are fascinating insights into her. I have always liked her for her lack of artifice. And I must say, in buying flats, I'm with her, except she's about five pairs more than me. I can get by with one pair. Anyway, I wanted to ask you about the rise of right-wing extremism in Germany, which was accelerated by COVID. And I have relatives in Germany. My parents originally came from a tiny island in the North Sea called Fur, which is owned by Germany. So my one cousin said to me that, you know, Germany has now lost three wars. He said, we lost the First World War, the Second World War, and the war on COVID. He is astounded that the German typical efficiency and planning, they're still in lockdowns. They have not excelled there. So that and it's accelerated the rise of right-wing extremism in Germany, which because of its history is all the more scary. So if you could comment on that.
Yes. Well, yes, indeed. The Alternative für Deutschland is a child of the Merkel era. And mm-hmm. It is a phenomenon that that is a direct outgrowth of her refugee policy, which, by the way, those 1 million Middle Eastern refugees have, for the most part, been successfully integrated. It's not a story in Germany. And the AfD is in the Bundestag, but is shrinking. It is now, I believe, in the single digits. It's gone from 12% to now 9%. So it is not. I'm pleased to tell you that that it's not a growing phenomenon. And I would venture, John, I don't know if you agree with me, that Germany will be the last European country to go to succumb to populism, because they have done such a good job of processing their darkest history. However, in the East, there's a population in East Germany that is susceptible to Putin and to other populists such as Orban, because they, unlike the West, they never went through the study of the Holocaust and the visits to the concentration camps. And in fact, Merkel herself had to be tutored on that. I write about who it was who brought her along on what precisely happened in the Holocaust. And one of her final trips as chancellor was to Auschwitz. Very moving. I describe it in great detail. So I'm happy to say that it's not a country wide issue. It's not a growing issue, but there is this core of East Germans who feel that that Merkel, who is one of them after all, did not acknowledge them sufficiently, and they've got a point. She is such a hyper-rational person, and because she was able to restart her engine, if you like, she didn't understand, you know, why they didn't grab a chance. Mm-hmm. to do the same and to embrace freedom. Mm-hmm. But she started very late in her time as chancellor. She started acknowledging the suffering of East Germans, and I thought it was very interesting that when she was given a military send-off, John, you probably observed
yeah,
that.
The tattoo.
And she chose as her two songs for the brass band to play, two East German pop songs from her youth.
Which one the band them. Had to learn, by the way.
You forgot the color film was one of them, I know. It was a bit late in the day for her to embrace her origins, but you know, she was always, you know, I was raised frankly the same way. I was a refugee, we didn't speak any English, and my parents said, you know, don't look back, look forward. And mm-hmm. so I well understand that mentality, but not everybody can follow that. But,
you know, one of the wake ups for me was in talking to people who grew up in the former East was I had always assumed that once that wall came down, it was a ding dong, the witch is dead moment. Not so much. People were, I mean, young people, they all moved west to get the job. So a lot of the investment right. didn't come into the East. It was expected. But secondly, you had all these people, they thought their savings disappeared overnight, their pensions disappeared overnight. They yeah. knew how to work within that system. And now all of a sudden they were told they were going to have to learn to work within a market economy. You know, that whole idea, mm-hmm. we pretend to work, you pretend to pay us. That was going out the window. And 1.5 million East Germans out of the 18 million were on the Stasi payroll. And that little piece yeah. of income just yeah. disappeared overnight. So yeah. it was actually yeah. a very scary moment. And as you suggest, a lot of people unfortunately didn't deal with that. And I also think part of the AfD, as you suggest, the refugee crisis was like jet fuel for those guys. But yes. once it hit a certain level, you know, Germany sort of came together and said, we aren't going down. We aren't going down this road.
They just assumed that it would come out of their pensions, which of course it didn't. But these are not rational things.
Let's go to another question. Hope Winthrop.
Yes. Knowing Angela Merkel as well as you do in her relationship with Putin, what do you think her reaction would be to the Russian-Ukraine situation today? What would she be advocating? Would she go as far as saying no about the pipeline, Nord Stream pipeline?
You know, Hope, that is such an interesting and important and complicated question, because I in my book, fault her for the Nord Stream. I think it's every time Obama asked her for an explanation for that, she gave a different answer. And the fact is that she's a calculating politician. On top of all these other wonderful things, she also, one of her mantras is the advantages outweigh the disadvantages. So Germany is dependent on for a big part of one third of its fuel on Russia. The Nord Stream is not up and running. So the Russians, Putin has no leverage there in turning off that pipeline, because it's in fact the Germans have more leverage by now signaling that indeed they will cut the pipeline if Putin goes ahead. But what Merkel would be doing right now it's precisely what she did in 2014 and 2015. She would be there. She would be all over this thing. She would have Putin in a fight to the finish and hold him to account as only she has been able to. And you know, I just hope that his entire modus operandi is as John said, is to disrupt. I believe he's testing the post-Merkel European Union.
No question about that.
And testing Biden as well. So you know, there's a lot at stake here, a great deal at stake. And I frankly think, I don't know about you, John, but or Jane as well, but I think the Biden administration is handling it well.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I also, you know, she did make a commitment to Biden that if there was an invasion, Nord Stream would not be opened up. My understanding, obviously I'm not in this room, but is that Olaf Scholz has also confirmed that commitment. You know, it was interesting. We were, during my time, we were very much against Nord Stream 2, largely for the geopolitical reasons. It gave Putin a little bit more strength in his, you know, hands around the neck of Ukraine. Because then he could cut off the, you know, pipeline, the gas through the Ukrainian pipeline. And she was always sort of pushing it off to, well, the business community needs it. And my coalition partner, the Social Democrats, want it. I think that we dealt with that more behind the scenes and very directly. Mm-hmm. And I think when the Trump administration made it such a pound on you every day issue, you know, if you want to get a world, a national leader to do go your way, probably not the best way to do it is to pound on them in public. So they then look like they're capitulating, particularly to a guy who had about 4% approval rating in the country that you lead. So I think that maybe, you know, led to it. But of course, the trick is, how do you define invasion? I mean, is that a cyber attack? Is that an invasion? Or a few more little green men? Is that an invasion? To see what would happen. But I agree with you 100%. She would be leading, corralling the Europeans. Yeah. And honestly, I think we miss that right now.
Boy, we sure do. Yeah.
So we've got, let's see, Steve Cohen and then Kay Koplowitz. And by the way, I don't know about you, Kati. I've got time. I don't have a back end. I'm willing to keep this going. Are you okay with that?
I'll try to follow Angela's leadership on this and stick and stay in my chair
until the last dog dies. Okay, Steve Cohen.
Nice to meet you. I now have two books I can look forward to reading.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, there are actually nine of them, but
no, thanks.
Start with two.
We're going to start with two. Yeah. All the research you did, can you give us an example of a decision she made that surprised you, that was out of character, and maybe an understanding of why?
Yeah, well, you know, she does rely on polling so that she's never too far ahead of her population. She's got, by nature, extraordinarily cautious and cunning in the best sense. So she doesn't, the 2015 refugee generous refugee policy was a shocker for almost everybody, including her close friends, not the people in her religious background, because it had this kind of Martin Luther moment that I alluded to for them. But I would say that was probably the most surprising, because not only the humanitarian gesture, but that she didn't have her ducks lined up as she normally would. It was a chaotic, originally there was chaos at the borders, and the Germans don't like chaos. And so that was a dangerous moment, but she, within 6 weeks, they had, you know, German efficiency came to the fore, and they got organized. Other things where were surprising about her, more character traits than policy, because I was not prepared at the outset for how canny she is, what a canny politician she is, and because she doesn't really advertise that, and that she will never, she never once criticized Trump. That to me is an act of remarkable self-control. And okay, here's a small thing. In preparation to meet him, to meet Trump, she watched an entire season of The Apprentice. Can anybody else make that claim? I don't think so. I will do a great deal for my country, but that deserves a National Order of Merit or something. So she she was that determined, in addition to reading all, you know, his Playboy interviews. And so she was well prepared. I don't think Trump really was a shocker for her, having observed his techniques on The Apprentice. I think she was as prepared as any human could be for what was to come.
We're going to go to Kay Koplovitz for the last question, and then I'm told we do have to wrap. So, Kay, the floor is yours. Good to see you.
This has been fascinating. Thank you so much for giving us a deep dive into, you know, this chancellor. I have a sort of more personal question. If I'm really curious, if you ever asked her what she thought her true strengths were. She is a woman of great accomplishment, wisdom, and ability to be an effective leader. But what would she say about herself?
First of all, she would dismiss the question. She would say that not for me to say. By the way, she doesn't give, you know, she doesn't sit down and open up to anybody.
I do Vanity Fair type interviews.
I was hoping with your relationship with her that she might. That's why I asked the question.
I think she tolerated my coming and going in the chancellery, and we had encounters. The only meal I had with her, John, was I don't know if I told you this, on Richard and I were in Berlin for the opening of the Holocaust Museum, and this reveals how she works. She always wants to learn from people who she thinks know what they're doing. And Richard had recently negotiated the Dayton Accord, so she asked to meet him. So we had dinner. There were just four of us, and the fourth arranged by Volker Schlöndorff, the great film director. The surprise guest table was Susan Sontag, and as a result, Richard never had a chance to talk about negotiating with Milosevic because Susan Sontag never paused for breath. So I just thought it was remarkable that it wasn't the politician Merkel, but the woman of letters Sontag, who completely sucked the oxygen out of that room. That would have been my chance for her to let her short hair down. But she would never ever go there. You know, to say this is, she wants her action to speak for herself, she doesn't trust words, for one thing.
Well, and your comment about that's not for me to say is just quintessential Merkel. Yeah. No question about it.
Yeah. Okay. She, by the way, she has a robust ego. You can't be a shy flower and present yourself to be Chancellor of Germany, the first woman chancellor. So she's as centered as an oak tree, I would say. But the ego is so well controlled.
Yeah, that's great. Any, before we throw it back to Patricia to wrap, any final comments that you'd like to make?
Well, I just want to say that it's just been so much fun for me to talk to you, John. I hope the rest of
back
you
at you.
Fabulous.
I do feel like we could go on for quite a while, and that she's, I'm not saying this just because I want you to read my book, which I do, but she is really an interesting character study. A fact she wasn't eager for the world to know. But now
that's a great you know, note to end on, and yet another reason to read the book to find out the answer to that.
Well, thank you so much. You've given us so many reasons for people to read the book. And I can't thank you enough, both of you, for coming on. We still had more questions to get to, but we ran out of time. But you gave us the big picture and a lot of tasty morsels about Angela Merkel. We did get to Ukraine, which is so concerning. But thank you so much. I mean, just having the two of you, because you both... have a relationship there and so much knowledge. Kati, it's just stunning. I'm sure you're going to get, when you get that book back on the bookshelves, I'm sure in the stores, next I'm week. Sure you're going to get next week. So you got to buy it. John, thank you so much. And thank you all for coming. I want to thank Calypso Leonard, who we're losing, since she goes off to some other exciting things. So thank you, Calypso. And thanks to our audience. You always have great questions. And please, on February 23rd, we're going to have Byron Wien and Joe Seidel with Anthony Scaramucci. Should be,
oh, that'll be interesting.
Very interesting. Forecast for 2022. So Scaramucci is going to moderate with Byron and Joe, and they're always really terrific. March 1, we're going to have Huma Abedin in person at the home of Alan Patrickoff, our legendary venture capitalist. That'll be fun. And of course, we'll do a Zoom as well. So I hope you'll come to that. March 10th, we've got Biden's first year with David Gergen, Tara Setmeyer, Ronald Brownstein. And we'll see who else we're going to get to that one. That'll be very interesting what he could have, should have done or will do. Thursday, March 24th, we'll have Harvard Institute of Politics, John Della Volpe on with a few young voices to talk about Generation Z. And Jane Harmon, you're always so helpful. We're gonna help us out with Congressman Connor Lamb on April 5th. And as you know, more to come. So please, hope we'll see you soon. Thank you, John. Kati, please come back.
Thank you, Patricia. Thank you, John. Love to you.
Thanks so much. See you both.
Great,
soon.
Great conversation, both of you. So fabulous.
Thanks, Kati. Thanks for organizing.
Good night, everyone. See you soon.
Okay.